brochure on the right rows. Did everybody pick up a brochure? Who needs a brochure? Raise your hand if you need a brochure. Ilka, would you get one for Suzanne?
That's what I was going to do.
They're in the back. I have a few announcements first. The first one is that all of the students who have indicated interest in working on the Sudan project, after the class is over, you're encouraged to attend the meeting that's going to be held. Where is
Jen and Melissa?
There's Melissa. Okay, Melissa's going to be meeting with you, and as I understand it, you're ready to move forward a bit. Okay, so everybody who indicated a desire, and I hope some of you who maybe have reconsidered and hadn't considered it in the past, that you will attend the meeting of the, quote, Human Rights Club to help set some things in motion, so that we can put our money where our mouth is, so to speak, about Darfur. If you haven't already, after the lecture is over, we have five piles in the front for your response papers, if you'll bring them here and put them in the appropriate pile. They're labeled, so find the name of your instructor and put your response paper there. Barbara and I will be handing back your midterm exams for our sections today, and we'll be somewhere around the room. Looks like we're using up a lot of the room. I want to invite students to come by the table with some additional information on the White Rose. Center for White Rose Studies, which needs your help if you are inspired by what you're going to hear today. I encourage you to take a newsletter from the organization, as well as a flyer indicating how you can help. We are most honored today. There's something else that was on my list to tell you about that you already know about, but we're most honored today to have people who are directly involved. There is an annual Yom HaShoah, or Holocaust commemoration, every year at Sonoma State. And this year, the Alliance for the Study of the Holocaust and the Jewish Community Agency are going to be putting on a very special program. It is a dramatic presentation of a Jewish family hiding in Berlin and the many non-Jewish people who helped them survive in Berlin, which is something you may not know about, but there were people who were able to survive through the help of other people. We have the playwright here, the person who wrote the play, our own Suzanne Batzdorf. And there will be someone from the community by the name of Ruth Gumpel who actually survived under those conditions. So that's Sunday, May 8th, in the Cooperage at 2 p.m. And I hope to see some of you there. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce our speaker to you on this crowded podium. Our speaker today is Ruth Sachs, who is president, founder, director of the Center for White Rose Studies. She's a third generation Houstonian, which she calls a rare breed. And for as long as she can remember, she's been writing. Ruth attended Texas Christian University and also has on her vita the very prestigious, she spent a very prestigious year as a Fulbright scholar in Germany. She's been named one of the notable women in Texas, and she began a career in 1989 as a freelance translator. I might mention she graduated cum laude from Texas Christian University with a BA in mathematics and also a BA in honors in German, which is quite an interesting combination. In December of 2000, she became the co-chair of the International Education Task Force of the Fulbright Association, and she believes that face-to-face discussion is the only way to affect lasting peace in the world, and that our strength comes from diversity. In addition to her writings on the White Rose, she has also written a book about Adolf Eichmann entitled Adolf Eichmann, the Engineer of Death. Her books about the White Rose include a history, some translations of primary source materials, which she has generously donated for our center library. She's also written a novel about the White Rose called Roses at Noon, and she has extended her writing to preparing media, including a CD. I would like to have you welcome Ruth Sachs, the director of the White Rose Foundation. Thank you.
I would like to say to all of you, Shalom, Guten Tag, hello, and for anyone who has ever been to either Munich or Stuttgart, where most of the story will take place, I would say, Grüßt euch Gott. How many of you have ever seen the Verhoeven movie about the White Rose or read Inge Scholz's book? Y'all are going to be the most surprised people in the room today. a couple of points of housekeeping. First, even though I will be pronouncing most of the names with a decidedly German accent, such as Traute Lafrenz or Hans Scholl, there are two names that I cannot pronounce in German because to me they just don't fit. That's Willy Graf and Alex Schmorell. Those two guys were outsiders and the biggest outsiders in their community. So when I say Willy and Alex, just forgive me and bear with me on that. The second and probably a more important housekeeping thing is the significance of this particular day for a discussion about the White Rose and the students who resisted Hitler in 1943. April the 19th was the date of the second White Rose trial when 14 students, and including a few adults, were put on trial before Roland Freisler, Hitler's hanging judge. Only 11 were supposed to have gone on trial, but at the last minute, the Gestapo threw in three women who they decided they didn't need to be indicted. They could just go to trial without an indictment. Of those, one was acquitted, three were sentenced to death, and the rest received varying but painful sentences in both prison and penitentiary. The same day, the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising was starting. This is the second, the White Rose story is almost enough to make you believe in metaphysics if you didn't believe in metaphysics before you knew their story. That's the second major coincidence between the Warsaw Ghetto and the White Rose. On July 22nd, the deportations began, and on July 22nd, the five of the White Rose students were preparing to go to the Russian front to serve as medics. Just, it's kind of mind-boggling how there's this little interconnection between two completely disparate groups. The third thing, and this ties into the question about how many have seen the movie or read the book, the reason that this story that you're going to hear today differs so greatly from the story as it's told in Germany is because censorship is sadly alive and well in Germany. People are claiming and have claimed through the years that they were part of resistance, specifically that they were part of White Rose resistance, when that's not borne out by primary source materials. They've used the heroism of a few people to try to hide their own Nazi activities. Unfortunately, they're allowed to do so because the denazification laws allow the denazification files to stay hidden until 5 years after their death and allow any Gestapo archival material to stay blocked until 30 years after their death or 30 years after the death of their descendants. So there's this major, major block where you know people were members of the Nazi Party or you know that they did this, that, or the other, but you can't access their documents to prove that they were not part of the resistance. So the books that are on the table, we had to choose a very, very bizarre binding method. Our histories are in three-ring binders, and every year we put out updates as a tiny little bit of the archives will trickle out, or this person will speak out and release some papers, or different things like that. When we announce a hard copy edition of our book, you'll know that censorship is gone in Germany. So that's kind of like, we'll be able to party when we can announce a hard copy edition. So before I get into who these people were, let me tell you a little bit about what they did. So some of the names are going to not mean anything to you until after I tell you what they did. Then we'll kind of backtrack and talk about the individuals. There was a group of students. Most of them were medical students, but not all. And most of the medical students studied philosophy on the side, though not all of them did. And they kind of got together and became really good friends, and they'd go skiing together, and they'd go drink wine together, and just basically had fun. They were just a good group of pals. They always were griping about Hitler and what they didn't like about the Nazis and the freedoms that they had lost under the Nazis. Well, a woman named Traute Lafrenz from Hamburg appeared in this group of students, became friends with them in May or June of 1941. But in Hamburg, she had been involved with the resistance group that when she was in high school, I mean, she wasn't even in college, when she was in high school, she and her pals distributed Thomas Mann's Responsa when he was kicked out of the university. They duplicated it and mailed it to everybody and distributed it. And then this same group of friends had Jewish friends and in their neighborhood, and they worked to save them and protect them. Well, she came to Munich then with this mindset where you don't just gripe, you get out and you do stuff. So when Traute shows up in May and June of 1941 and starts dating Hans Scholl, well, she's like, you guys have got to quit griping. You guys have got to start doing stuff. Well, they kept griping, but they started talking about doing stuff. In November of 1941, a group of high school students from Ulm, where a lot of the people from the White Rose hailed from, these high school kids duplicated Bishop Gallen's sermons about euthanasia and about the T4 program, and they sent them out to several hundred people, among them the Scholl family in Ulm. Well, Hans got this copy, and he's like, oh, yeah, this is a good idea. Even though he was dating Traute, he wasn't listening to her because she had said sending out leaflets is a great idea. Well, when he gets this in the mail, he understands what a good idea it is to distribute material that says what the Nazis were doing that was bad, but he still didn't do anything. His sister Sophie came to Munich in May of 1942 to study natural sciences, and she basically was, you guys get off your butts. You just have been sitting here doing nothing. You talk all the time. All you're doing is philosophy, philosophy, philosophy. Philosophy didn't get you anywhere. You've got to start doing something. Her second day in Munich, as her fiancé slash boyfriend was heading to the Russian front, he stopped by to visit her in Munich, and she's like, Fritz, can you get me a duplicating machine? He's like, what do you need a duplicating machine for? She's like, well, you can get it. You know, you're a captain in the German army. You can get a requisition slip, and, if I were to ask for a duplicating machine, what would they think? You know, I'm just a student, I'm a girl. And he's like, no, you can't do that, or you've got to tell me first why you need this duplicating machine. And so she could never hide anything from him, so she finally says, okay, well, we want to do these leaflets, we want to mail them to everybody. And he told her, Sophie, you could lose your head for doing that. And she said, I know, but that's what we want to do. Well, he wouldn't do it, something he lived to regret. He kicked himself till the day he died for not having done what she wanted. She would not let her brother and his friends off the hook. She bothered them and pestered them and kept at them until in late May, they finally bought a duplicating machine, and in June, they finally started writing leaflets. Her brother wrote the first one. It's in your books if you'll open it. We're not going to read the whole thing because it would take forever to read the whole thing. But the very opening line, I think, is just, it speaks to us right now in the year 2005. Nothing is more shameful to a civilized nation than to allow itself to be governed by an irresponsible clique of sovereigns who have given themselves over to dark urges, and that without resisting. But you couldn't ask for stronger words. Hans went on to write about Goethe and Germany as a tragic nation. And interestingly, he says, like the Jews and Greeks. But he talks about them being nothing but opportunists who just are willing to follow the herd. He goes on to, and this is what bothered Sophie a lot, he goes on to justify resistance, and at this point they were just talking about passive resistance, with all kinds of philosophy. But he does end it with this thing, you know, saying, he quotes, who does he quote? He quotes Goethe's The Awakening of Epimenides by saying, you know, cry anew and enraptured, freedom, freedom, freedom. That really was the key for everything they did, is they could not stand that all of their freedoms had been taken away. They sent out a couple of test balloons of this, and then in late June 1942, they got together with a bunch of friends, and it was supposed to be a literary soiree where they got together and talked about Paul Claudel and all kinds of important things like that. And instead, they ended up talking about politics. Well, there were a couple of adults in the room who were a little uncomfortable with what these students were saying about, we need to resist, we need to say no, we need to do all this. And these adults, one of whom was their beloved Professor Kurt Huber, kind of was taken aback and didn't know what to think. Huber had been a member of the Nazi Party since 1940, but he was one of the original signers of the Nazi Party's protest of the Dawes Plan in 1923. And he was, you know, he didn't like some of the things they did, but, you know, if anything, he thought Germany needed to take a right-hand swing that Hitler had made Germany too liberal. So here he is sitting listening to these students that are saying totally heretical things, and they had sent him one of these leaflets, and he hadn't known what to think of that. But it was a pretty disturbing, it didn't turn out to be a literary soiree at all. They talked about very important things. They were so encouraged by what they perceived to be the response to this first leaflet that they wrote a second one, and Hans Scholl wrote the first part, and then where it really gets practical, that was where Alexander Schmorell came into play. He was otherwise known as Shurik, his Russian nickname. And in it, they wanted to open the eyes of their neighbors and friends to the atrocities that the Germans were committing. They had a friend who, he was an architect, who every once in a while loaned them use of his studio just to get together and talk. And Eichemeyer worked in Krakow at the time. And so he was hearing and seeing about some of these things firsthand, and he would come back and say, my God, can you believe they've killed 300,000 Jews? And they were like, oh, that's terrible. They've killed 300. I mean, it's a good thing some of these people didn't live to the end, because they would have really been shocked. But they thought, if we tell people, then surely everybody will just rise up. Nope, you know, nobody knows that they've murdered 300,000 Jews in Poland. If they knew, the whole country would just absolutely come together and get rid of Hitler. So they wrote this. And like I said, Alex wrote the most powerful words in it. And among the most powerful words, he's talking about the people who just are willing to sit in their homes and not do anything. He says, these people must not merely feel pity, no, much more. They will share in the guilt. He was absolutely convinced that anybody who knew, once they read this leaflet where they knew that 300,000 Jews had been murdered, that they were guilty. And he said, everyone is guilty, 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 but it is not too late to rid the world of this most awful of miscarriages of government, not of justice, but of government, in order to avoid incurring even more guilt. And then Hans Scholl latched on a bunch of philosophical stuff that, you know, you kind of roll your eyes at, but that was their second leaflet. And they also sent it to Kurt Huber to kind of get under his skin a little bit. They did these leaflets really in quick succession. The next week they did leaflet three, which was the Gestapo hated this leaflet the worst of all, because in it, again, Hans wrote the first part, Alex wrote the second part, and Alex wrote the part that was really most practical. He was like, how do you resist? Okay, we've told you you need to resist. Now, how do you resist? Okay, you start sabotaging this, you sabotage this, you sabotage that. And he gives them this long list of things that they needed to be sabotaging in order to bring down the Nazis. It's a good reason for this to have been the one that they hated the worst. Then their fourth and final leaflet for the summer was just completely Hans Scholl again. And in it, he goes back to attacking Hitler. Every word that proceeds from Hitler's mouth is a lie. When he says peace, he means war. When he names the name of the Almighty in a most blasphemous manner, he means the Almighty, evil one, that fallen angel, Satan. He uses a lot of religious imagery to try to hook the very religious population of Munich, because Munich was and is about 98% Catholic. I will ask you, those of you who claim to be Christians, in this struggle for the preservation of your most precious goods, is there a hesitancy, a pretense of intrigue, procrastination of your decision in the hopes that someone else will raise his weapons to defend you? We must attack the evil one where it is strongest. Traute loved this one because she wasn't quite sure at this point whether Hans and Alex were the ones who were writing it, but she had told him that she liked a certain part in Ecclesiastes that starts off, "Wherefore I praise the dead which are already dead more than the living which are yet alive." And when she saw that in this leaflet, she's like, "Okay, I know it's them. I know it's them." There was not a doubt in her mind. How did they do this? Well, it was very, very difficult. At this point, the only people working on the leaflet were four people: Hans, Alex, Sophie, and a guy named Christoph Probst. They had a very small hand-cranked duplicating machine that was very cantankerous, took a lot of effort to get. Each of these leaflets was four pages long in the original, so they did 100 pages of each, which meant that they were hand-churning 100 of these, hand-typing 100 envelopes, and mailing them, going to different post offices to try to not arouse suspicion. But they were also getting very frustrated because they realized that 100 leaflets at a time were not going to get them very far. A major event in their life, and interestingly enough too, the Gestapo loved them. Like a third of the Gestapo interrogation centered on this one event. On July 22nd, as they were getting, five of the guys were getting ready to be sent to the Russian front, they held a farewell party at Manfred Eichemeyer's studio. And at that point, they really began to talk about, okay, we've tried this, we've tried the leaflets, it's not working, what can we do? So they began to realize that if they were going to be effective, they were going to have to expand their organization, and they began to talk about assassinating Hitler. That was the July 22nd farewell party. And there were probably 15 or 20 people at this party, a third of which were women, which does not tend to be talked about very much in normal white rose thing, which is all these guys doing stuff. The main impetus for most of the work was actually the women. They were sent to the Russian front, and strangely enough, the German army let them stay together, which just didn't happen that much. And while they were there, they began to see some of the atrocities and some of the bestial behavior of the Germans for themselves. It wasn't anymore what Manfred Eichemeyer told them. It was what they had seen themselves. Willy Graf had served on the Russian front for a full year before he came to Munich. And for him, this was just a renewal of his nightmares, where he had seen terrible, terrible things. Villages burned, people herded into barns, the barns set on fire, and he couldn't handle it. So while they were on the Russian front, it just strengthened their commitment that they had made at the end of July, where they decided they had to do something. At this time, Sophie and Traute, although they weren't on the Russian front, they were actually busy as well. Sophie was kind of nurturing this high school kid named Hans Hirzel to try to get him to agree to take over the operations in Stuttgart, because they knew that they were spread too thin. And she also, most importantly for the group, made contact with a family friend named Eugen Grimminger, who was an accountant in Stuttgart. That Robert Scholl had been imprisoned for insulting Hitler. Now, Robert Scholl was not anti-Nazi by any stretch of the imagination. That was the father of Hans and Sophie Scholl. He was not anti-Nazi. He his top clients. He was also in a panel at his top clients were all the big shot Nazis in Ulm. He just didn't like the fact that Hitler was losing the war because he didn't want Germany to be overrun by Americans and British after the war. But he made the mistake of insulting Hitler, so he spent 2 months in jail. And while he was in jail, this Eugen Grimmier came and helped him out by running his business while he was in jail. Well, Eugen was married to a Jewish woman named Jenny Stern, and he had been involved with resistance by smuggling Jews out of the country, including most of her family. She was the only one of her family who died in Auschwitz. Smuggling them out, he hid assets of Jews who left the country. And in fact, there's some very moving testimonials from some of those friends who were able to come back and get their jewelry and stuff that he had buried in his backyard. Well, here Sophie gets this one-on-one chance to talk to this guy, and he's excited that there's these students who are actually doing resistance. So when the boys come back from the Russian front, then Sophie tells Hans, you need to talk to Eugen Grimminger because he'll finance our operations. Well, Hans and Alex went to see Grimminger almost as soon as they got back, and he was thrilled, and his secretary, a woman named Tilly Hahn, was also quite excited. Between the two of them, they recruited people who gave over $40,000 to make the White Rose operations possible in the future. And Eugen Grimminger noted after the war, every single person who contributed except for him was a woman. He said the women made the best anti-fascists. While Hans and Alex were visiting him, they also went to visit Falk Harnack, whose brother was Arvid Harnack, who was involved with the Harnack-Schulze boys and resistance movement in Berlin, and that which later the Gestapo dubbed it the Red Orchestra. What the Red Orchestra tried to do was make America and Russia talk to each other. They're like, Germany can never be conquered until Russia and the United States talk to each other. So they would pass military secrets back and forth, hoping to make a bridge between East and West to bring down Hitler. And then, of course, the Gestapo said, oh, they were communists. Anyone who does anything with Russia is a communist. And so they dubbed them that. The interesting thing about Arvid's wife is she was the only American killed for her resistance during World War II. She was from Wisconsin, where Arvid had met her on a Roosevelt Exchange Scholarship. So she had actually had the chance to go back to America and take Arvid. And she's like, no, Germany needs me more than America does. So she stayed. Traute, at the same time that all this was going on, went to Hamburg and Vienna trying to get her old friends back interested in what the White Rose was doing. And in Vienna, she had an aunt and uncle who were very much anti-Nazi, who she helped to be able to get some equipment from, like a better duplicating machine. On January the 13th, it was important for two reasons. One, there was a big student rally at the University of Munich to celebrate the 450th anniversary of the university. Well, the Gauleiter, or the head of the entire region of Munich, made all these insulting comments about the women students. Some of them were so vile that people said, I couldn't even write them down. They were so vile. He basically told the women, you don't need to be taking up a space at the university. You need to get pregnant, have a son for the Führer. If you're too ugly to find a boy who'll sleep with you, I've got a lieutenant. He'll do it. And the women just came unglued. They were so upset. And so they marched out in protest. And the soldiers stood up in their defense, just absolutely irate that all this was going on. And these students took to the streets a minute, protesting the Gauleiter speech. Well, the Gestapo originally was going to try to arrest them, but there were too many, so they couldn't. But they just pretended it never happened. It never made the newspapers, never whatever. Well, the same night that that was going on, the kids in the White Rose had decided they weren't going to go to this thing. It was a Nazi celebration, so they weren't even there. They found out about it from other friends who had gone. And they, that night, started production of the fifth leaflet. And I won't read it here, but I hope that you'll take the time later to read it. This was another Hans Scholl product. And it's a call to all Germans. And they changed from the White Rose name to calling themselves now the Leaflet of the Resistance Movement in Germany, because they were trying to implement what they had talked about with making this a broader movement, where it wasn't just a little bitty group of students in Munich, but that they were connected to other cities and other groups who were also interested in the same thing. And he really tried to point out that Hitler was losing the war. He tried to call on the German pride in their military to try to say, you know, you shouldn't support Hitler, because if you do, he's going to lose the war anyhow, so you may as well get rid of him so there's some hope for us. He called them a band of criminals, things like that. Used a lot of very strong National Socialist imagery against the Nazis themselves. And then he ended with what was, again, their mantra: freedom of speech, freedom of religion, the protection of the individual citizen from the caprice of criminal violent states. These are the bases of the new Europe. They did about 10,000 of these leaflets. By now they had gotten a better duplicating machine, but there still were just the four of them doing the duplicating, and then people like Traute and Käthe and others would run errands for them, or, you know, go pick up envelopes. Eugen Grimminger gave them tons of envelope and papers that they could use in this. And Eugen kept sending Tilly to Munich with more money, more paper, more envelopes. In fact, she nearly got caught because she made the mistake of sending him a telex from Munich saying, "I made it." And the Gestapo was kind of upset about that. On January the 31st, Christoph Probst wrote another leaflet that never got published. And he wrote it after the Roosevelt speech, after the Casablanca meeting between him and Roosevelt. And Christoph was so taken by Roosevelt's words that he was like, "Roosevelt's the greatest man," and that really comes out in his thing, which, of course, that did not endear him to the Gestapo when they found that either, because Roosevelt was not very well liked in Germany. They undertook what to me was the most audacious campaign. The night of February the 3rd, Alex had gotten an artist named Wilhelm Geyer to teach him how to make templates out of tin, and the template said, "Down with Hitler." And each of the letters was about 3 feet tall, so it was "Down with Hitler," so that when they painted it on the walls, it was 6 feet tall. It's as big as a man, the Gestapo said about it. And they used black tar-based paint that would not come off with anything. And they did this between February the 3rd and February the 15th, three times, in over 70 places in Munich. And they would go out, they would attack some of the most unbelievable places that were, it was like directly under the Nazis' nose. They would go paint this, and then they'd paint a swastika that was crossed out. And then on the university, they freehand painted "freedom, freedom, freedom" all over the place, so that no matter where, how you came in, you saw the word "freedom" painted on the university. And then, unfortunately, on February the 9th, 9 days before they were about to be arrested, they had a very tragic rift among them. Kurt Huber had, by this time, their professor, had begun to accept a lot of their anti-Nazi rhetoric, where, and a lot of that was innate in him too, because he did believe in the freedom of the university, the freedom of professors to teach, the freedom of people to think as they wanted to. And even though he was an agnostic, he believed in freedom of religion, which they did not have. But at the same time, he never could get past his belief that the Nazi Party would bring about a better Germany. He didn't argue too much with the points that were kicking Jews out of Germany. Because he was like, "We need a pure Germany, a racially pure Germany." So here he is, on the one hand, teaching this beautiful, in the most gorgeous words possible, you know, freedom of the individual. On the other hand, he doesn't get the disconnect that he's not wanting the same thing for all individuals. He's wanting it just for German individuals. Then you bring in Falk Harnack, who has this broad East-West, "We need to work with the communists, we need to work with that." And you put those two guys in the same room with these very idealistic students, and it was a very explosive situation. They said a lot of harsh words. Huber began calling Harnack, and then Alex, who defended Harnack, started calling him, "Oh, you commie, you," and, you know, just belittling them, and wouldn't even let them speak, would put them down. So February 9th was really a breaking point for the group. And they decided that they were going to have to just stop, that they could do one more thing. And so they, Huber had written this wonderful leaflet, and it's the last, the sixth leaflet. And again, please read it, because it is just too powerful. But he had written this wonderful leaflet that they did publish, and yet at the same time, they couldn't go on. For one thing, Willie wanted them to be more active. He thought that they were not going to get anywhere if all they did was just keep on producing leaflets. So he was looking for a group that would really concentrate on assassinating Hitler and overthrowing the government. That was what he wanted. Alex thought that he needed to be more involved in Russia. Since he was half Russian, he thought that if he went back to Russia, that he could help his country overcome their problems. So the group was splintering, and as they did, Hanschel came up with this idea for one last big thing. So they did one more graffiti campaign, and then he convinced them to run off more leaflets, and then he and Sophie took them to the university on February the 18th. And the original goal was just for them to set them outside the classroom doors so that when students came out of the classrooms, they would find these piles of paper and they'd pick them up out of curiosity. And it's still a pretty much accepted way in Germany to communicate. People still put leaflets outside, and it's just the way they do things. So they were supposed to do that, and then they were supposed to exit out the back of the university and go down the back alleys to their house. That was the plan. Well, if anyone had talked to Sophie right before, they would have known that that wasn't the plan. That was the official plan, but that wasn't the plan. Because she told Wilhelm Geyer 2 days before this was planned that she did not ever want to be arrested quietly. She wanted to be arrested publicly because she felt like if she was arrested publicly, that the hue and cry over this 21-year-old woman being arrested for her beliefs would be enough to stir up the populace. The leaflets hadn't done it, but this young, beautiful German girl, that she thought enough about this issue to take a public stand, that then the whole city would rise up and rescue her. That was what she told Wilhelm Geyer. So instead of putting the leaflets out and going out the back way and going home, they decided to dump them over the balcony just as class was letting out. Well, that would have been fine too, except that the janitor saw them. And when that happened, then the whole thing came unraveled. The janitor was able to apprehend them, took them to the Gestapo. They were arrested on February the 18th. Their trial was 9 o'clock in the morning, February the 22nd. So Thursday they were arrested. Monday morning was the trial. They were sentenced by noon to death. It was Hans, Sophie, and Christoph, because Hans stupidly had the seventh leaflet in his pocket when he was arrested. And contrary to the movie, he did not try to shove it down his mouth. So he was trying to tear it up into little pieces, and they were able to piece it back together. Stupidly, when they asked him who wrote it, he said Christoph Probst. Well, they would have never gotten Christoph because he lived in Innsbruck. He didn't even live in Munich. The Gestapo report was, well, it's a good thing he told us this because we thought he had written it. You know, so you're like, why did he betray his best friend? This doesn't make any sense. And Sophie betrayed Traute, but the worst one was that Hans's last girlfriend was a person named Gisela Schertling. And she was a good Nazi, and Hans knew she was a good Nazi before he ever started going out with her. And so she thought that she could make amends for everything, and so she just gave the Gestapo everyone's names. It's like, yes, there's something. She started name. She named people that came around once. You know, oh yeah, they were in the middle of everything. So this second trial then took place on April the 19th, like I said, and then the third trial was July the 13th. Well, the four guys who were on trial on July the 13th, their files had gone back and forth from Berlin to Munich so many times that the Gestapo lost it. They lost the evidence. They lost the interrogation transcripts. They lost everything. So Gisela, who had ratted them out in the first place, they call her as the main witness. And they're like, you know, you said Wilhelm Geyer did this, you said Harald Dorn did this. And she's like, I never said that. Nope, I didn't say that. So she redeemed herself in the end because these four guys who were all supposed to have been gotten a death sentence were in the end then spared. All of them, one of them got 6 months in prison, and all the other three were acquitted for lack of evidence, which is kind of unusual that the Nazi criminal system would let anyone go for lack of evidence. So this is what they did. Now let me briefly go through who they were. This is how I got hooked on the White Rose. This is the calendar from July of 1994. I had never heard of them, and I had been taking German since seventh grade, and I had never heard of these people. And then here they were on this calendar. Well, I got attracted because that's Munich when Fern blows in, when the southern Italian wind comes into the city. And it's a very rare shot to be able to get a picture like that. It happens only once every several years. So I was looking at that, and I was like, oh, these people, they must have been communists, otherwise I would have heard about them. So they weren't. These are the people. Why is it not going forward? Where's the techie person? It's not going forward. Sorry.
Happens.
We probably want it to be used before now. Okay. Harald Dorn was not executed as part of the first White Rose thing. He was Christoph Kolb's father-in-law. He's a very unusual man. He was part of the problem as far as the dissent within the group, because he believed that Germany needed to be run by a theocracy. He had converted to Catholicism from Russian Orthodoxy and thought that that the Catholic Church needed to run everything, which nobody agreed with, even the Catholics in the group. He participated in the January 1943 meetings and mentored Crystal, where after he was acquitted in July of 1943, he kept up with his resistance work and joined a group of translators who actually succeeded in the only coup in Germany. They were able to liberate Munich before the Americans came in, so that when the Americans marched into Munich, it was all the Nazis had already been overthrown. And it was called Operation Freedom Bavaria. And he was one of those, and he was murdered on May the 5th, 1945, shot in the back in Perlacher Forest for his role in that. But at the same time, even though he was a problem as far as his theocracy stuff, he still was very critical for his thoughts about freedom and why that was important. One of my favorites of the whole group, Willy Graf, he was from Saarbrücken. His father, Gerhard Graf, helped establish the Nazi Party in the Saarland. So Willy did not exactly come from a home that was against Hitler. In fact, there's a very famous League of Nations lawsuit that his father helped the Nazis win by bugging. It's kind of like a Nazi Watergate thing, where they bugged the restaurant that Gerhard Graf owned and got some dirt on the League of Nations people who were trying to keep the Nazi Party from being founded in the Saarland. And so that was Gerhard Graf who enabled that. Willy's resistance was based on his moral objections to what he had seen. Like I said, he saw the Russian villages being burned. He saw Jews being murdered. He saw bodies lying in ditches. He saw all this when he was on the Russian front for a year. And I believe that if he had lived, he would have been a basket case, because he took it all so seriously. And it was like, you can't do this. He was also very devoutly Catholic, but he thought that the Catholic Church needed to be reformed. He was the Renouveau, I don't speak French very well, Renouveau Catholique, that was Paul Claudel and Bernanos and writers like that at the end of the 19th century. He very much agreed with their thoughts that the Catholic Church had lagged way too far behind and needed to catch up to the rest of the world with things like separation of church and state, freedom for the arts, less restriction on people who were Catholic. He also never belonged to Hitlerjugend. He's one of the few who never did. He would strike out, when he was 14, 15 years old, he would strike out names of any of his friends who joined Hitlerjugend. But they ceased to exist for him if they gave in and succumbed. It didn't matter if they'd been his best friend at that point. If they gave in, they were gone. My favorite two things with him, and these were both when he was in high school, he and a bunch of his other Catholic friends that belonged to different youth groups, when the Tsar returned to Germany in 1935, Rudolf Hess came and was receiving all these groups who, you know, now were marching in Nazi uniform. Well, Willy and his friends refused to wear anything that resembled a swastika or brown and white. But because they refused to do that, they weren't welcome in this parade. So they all hid in an alley and found a break in the line and dashed in carrying a Christian flag and marched by Hess. And instead of giving the Nazi salute, they just went like this. And then he said, we ran off like the wind, because they would have bad things would have happened to them. They were about 14 or 15 at that time. And then a year later, there was another big rally, and this time they were told they could not have their Christian flag anywhere around. And so they were able to take their school flag, which had all these beat up tassels on it, and it had no swastikas. So he said, we marched extra slow just to bother the Hitler Youth people. So, and he also did not betray one person when he was arrested. His transcripts are just an incredible thing to read. He's the one in the middle. His sister, Annalisa, was at the university at the same time. She's the one on the far right. It's not doing it. It won't go. Okay. That's Professor Kurt Huber. He was originally from Switzerland, but when he was 3, his family moved to Stuttgart. So for all practical purposes, he was one of the Stuttgarters. And he was really a rock star in the sense as we would understand that today. He had gotten together with a Bavarian folk song person named Kim Pauli, who revived Bavarian folk music. And this was in the late 20s, early 30s, right before the Nazis had come to power, but as that movement was coming up, and they started a folk festival in Munich. And there's even like a 48-second clip on Bayern 1, one of the 3 Bavarian radio stations, that has the advertisement for the 1930 folk song festival with Kurt Huber and Kim Pauli. It's kind of funny. But everywhere he went, he was a true celebrity. Like I said before, he was a diehard member of the Nazi Party, believed it had become too liberal, and needed to take a hard right turn. He was truly a White Rose mentor for his notions of freedom. When you read the 6th leaflet, I think you'll be amazed that somebody who had any Nazi inclinations could write something that powerful. The 6th leaflet is also filled with all kinds of innuendo that only somebody who was a member of the party and who had access to the top-ranking party members would know. Like, he made fun of the Gauleiter who had done that January 13th insulting by saying he was a Gauleiter hopeful, which very few people knew because the guy was not qualified to be Gauleiter. So he was kind of like the acting Gauleiter, but he didn't ever let anybody know that that was the case. And then he made fun of the chancellor of the university by pointing out that he had no academic credentials. You know, things that only somebody who was very in with the top dogs would know, which is why they really hated him. Whoops, that one. There. This is one of my other favorites, Christoph Probst. He's often called the moral backbone of the White Rose because he just had a very strong sense of ethics. He was the only married member of the inner group. He had 3 children when he died. He wrote the 7th leaflet that was unpublished. His stepmother was Jewish, and he and the town of Celle in Bayern, Bavaria, protected her till the end of the war. So she was one of the few people in that community that survived. He was very fascinated by Eastern religions, and he was Alex's best friend. They had known each other since high school. Just, you know, the kind of friend that you want to have, that everybody wants. His son today looks just, his son that we got to meet and talk to is the little kid on his shoulders, and his son now looks just like he did. He was very Bavarian. He even made Alex wear Bavarian suspenders when he became his son's godfather, which Alex hated. He liked the idea of a parliamentarian monarchy, but Hans Scholl wanted the British version, and Crystal thought that they needed something that wasn't quite so British. He was not a big fan of England. Harald Dorn's nephew and Crystal's brother-in-law, Klaus Dorn, was part of the Viennese resistance, and he was exiled to England in 1938, where he continued resistance from afar, but still kept writing and sending stuff. There's Alex. He was half Russian, felt more Russian than German, wanted to be a sculptor, not a doctor, but sculptors were not given wartime exemption to stay at the university, so he decided it was more important to be a student than a soldier, so he gave up his sculpting dreams. He was fun-loving, full of life. His philosophy was The poorer people are the ones that you can always count on. The richer people will fail you every time. He felt very much like an other. He penned the words about the Jewish question, which took a lot of guts, and provided the connection to the Harnack-Schulze boys in the group. He was deeply, deeply hurt by the February 9th rift, because to have his beloved professor call him a communist and not understand what he was about, just, it was more than he could take. Hans and Sophie are very often called the leaders of the White Rose. And that's mainly because their sister Inge was the head of a number two person of the League of German Girls in Ulm. Inge Scholl taught the anti-Semitic and racial ideology of the Nazi Party to all of the League of German Girls leaders in the city. Inge Scholl was very strongly anti-Semitic. She, after the war, invented three philo-Semitic stories about her family that are nothing but trash to make themselves look better. Fortunately, in the last couple of years, Elizabeth Hartnagel, Nay Scholl, has started coming out and saying, what my sister did was wrong. This group was not run by my siblings. They were just part of the group. They had their responsibilities like everybody else had their responsibilities. The cult worship of Hans and Sophie Scholl is wrong. And it's like, okay, Elizabeth, speak up a little louder, please. Otto Eicher, now we're on to the ones who didn't die. Otto Eicher was a very strong influence on Sophie Scholl. He actually married Inge Scholl after the war, and he's the one that told most of the really fun stories about Inge, such as the time she stopped the Führer's car when he was in Ulm. She walked out into the middle of the street and made him stop and salute her. He was in Munich in February of 1943 to talk to the Scholls about joining the White Rose, but that fell apart because his meeting was February the 18th at noon and they were arrested at 11. He was very devoutly Catholic, like Willie, but he believed that they needed to clean house from the top down, beginning with the Pope. He felt like the Pope was the biggest part of the problem that Germans who tried to resist Hitler were facing. His book, Innenseiten des Kriegs, is very definitely worth reading if you can read German and are interested in the view of somebody who really thought about his religion and its role in what was going on in the 1930s and 1940s. An interesting side note about this guy, I don't know if your German department here has any of the 1972 Olympic posters. No, you don't? Yeah. They're brightly colored, just gorgeous, gorgeous posters. And they were, the whole 1972 Olympic design was by Otto Eicher. And his whole concept and goal for Munich's 1972 Olympics was not to make the world believe that Munich had changed, but to make the world understand that the world had changed. There are no colors from any flags that were in existence as of 1972. He used all neutral colors. He invented the sports pictograms that we just now take for granted. Those didn't exist before the 72 Olympics. He was like, nobody should be excluded from the Olympics because of their language. He tried to globalize it and make us see we're all part of the same thing. We're all responsible for each other. And it's just really tragic that those were the Olympics that got ruined. Next. These two, unfortunately, no pictures. Helmut Bauer and Heinrich Bullinger were trying to get the White Rose leaflets distributed in Freiburg, but unfortunately, they tried to do so just as everything was coming to an end. They were Willy Graf's friends. He recruited them for this. They were imprisoned with Eugen Kreminger in Ludwigsburg. Helmut's father was a Nazi bigwig, and it's possible that because of that, he was treated extra harshly. He was assigned to work in a tuberculosis ward and died shortly after the war because he contracted tuberculosis. The German army also went out of its way to persecute Helmut Bauer. He had not been released from the army, so his going on trial on April 19th was illegal because members of the army had to be tried in a military court. He had not been released, so the whole thing was illegal, but his 7 years in penitentiary, the army decided that he had to serve it, and then the army would try him too. Oh, and the archives for these two are missing, and I just found out a couple of months ago from somebody in Brussels that it's possible that those archives are actually in Washington, D.C., because evidently all the Freiburg archives were moved to D.C. Manfred Eichemeyer, also in the photograph, he made his studio available and was really the one who gave them the information that they needed to write the leaflets and to understand why their resistance was not just a matter of personal freedom, but why Germany needed it. Interesting aside, for anyone who studies Greek, his brother-in-law was Kurt von Fritz, who was a professor of Greek in Rostock, and von Fritz refused to sign the Nazi oath of allegiance that all university professors had to sign, so he was fired. So State University of Albany in New York got him. Gerhard Feurle is one of my favorites. He was fringe of a fringe. He was this scared, insecure, mouse of an artist who, you know, stereotypical artist, if you can just imagine that. Very good friends with Wilhelm Geyer. Fell in love with Sophie Scholl, and even when he felt like an outsider, he would come just to be close to her. And when they would meet at the studio, there was kind of like this little outside room, and he didn't feel worthy to sit in with the rest of them because they all were so smart and he was so stupid. So he would sit in the outside room and just listen. But he wrote probably one of the most memorable of all White Rose lines, where he said that this group and what they did and what they said helped him save his face because the Nazis had stolen his. He died mysteriously in 44, 45. The Gestapo always thought that he had taught Alex how to make the template, so they followed him all the way to the Russian front and back, and nobody knows whether he's dead or missing in action. Wilhelm Geyer is another favorite. He was an old man, he was 40. If he had been born 10 years earlier or 15 years later, everybody who's an art student would know more about him, because he and some of his friends in Stuttgart had started a brand of art that mixed expressionism and impressionism, and they were just gaining acceptance when the Nazis came to power and banned them. So his work, you know, he went through the most creative period of his life not being allowed to paint. Julius Streicher called him the most dangerous artist in Germany. In 1933, he brazenly went up to the middle of a Nazi rally in Ulm and disbanded it by himself. He was Sophie Scholl's mentor, constant companion of the Scholls from January the 11th to February the 17th, and he taught Alex how to make the template for graffiti. Wonderful man. His family are just incredible people. They allowed us into their home, invited us for coffee and cake every Thursday with part of their family tradition, and just said, here's everything he wrote, everything. There's no censorship. Whatever he wrote, whatever he said, it's yours to read. And just, it was like, that kind of openness is very, very rare. Eugen Grimminger was the oldest person involved in White Rose resistance. He was 50 when he was arrested, 51 a couple of weeks later. He financed their operations and recruited others who gave. His wife, Jenny, was murdered at Auschwitz in December 1943, and he attempted suicide in the penitentiary shortly after that. Very, very difficult for him. A brilliant man, he'd been a novelist. He was a CPA, but he was also a novelist, had a published romance novel, and like I said, worked with the French resistance to get Jewish Germans out of Germany. And that's his wife, Jenny, on the left. Heinrich Guter was a very young high school student who never should have been implicated except for Hans Hirzel, who, like Gisela Schertling, named every name he could think of. All he did was know about the leaflets. He never touched one. He never distributed one. He did nothing. He knew about it, and he got 18 months in prison. But he was such an anti-Nazi that he was rejected from membership in Hitler Youth. I like that. Theodor Hecker was one of the philosophers and theologians who influenced mainly Hans and Sophie, more Hans than Sophie, and he influenced Otto Leischer. His February 4th reading galvanized. If they had just not had the February 9th meeting, then they probably could have gone on to do greater things, because his February the 4th meeting just galvanized the students. And he made the famous statement that Germans will one day wear the swastika the same way that we make Jews wear the Star of David. I think that was in 1940 that he made that statement. Tilly Hahn She was their liaison between the money and the work. She gave $4,000 of her own money, and actually Bear almost was arrested herself because she was bringing them a duplicating machine just as the Gestapo was searching their house. She saved Eugen Gröminger's life during the April 19th trial by being a really good flirt. His court-appointed counsel was actually kind of a decent guy, which was scary. And when she had testified before, and he realized that she would be a really good second witness, so he called her back, and she bowed to Judge Frey. So she refused to give the Hitler salute or anything like that, but she bowed to Freisler, stroked his ego, batted her eyes, crossed her legs, you know, did all this real flirtatious stuff and said, my boss could never do anything like that. And instead of getting the death sentence, which he had certainly been going to get, he got 10 years in penitentiary. Falk Harnack, brother of Arvid, his goal was to hook the students in Munich up with Berlin resistance. And he was Lilo's friend and confidant, and the next picture is that's Alex, Lilo, and Falk. They were three great friends, and their friendship meant a lot to them. That's Lilo and Falk on the Walchensee. I think it's important to remember these were people who had real lives. Hans Herzl, he handled the leaflet distribution in Stuttgart, but he was totally a basket case. He took LSD, and he took LSD because he liked to see dead things talk. And his father was one of the people who actually signed the Bonhoeffer Confession, but at the same time thought that Hitler was good for Germany. So it's like, I don't understand how he could sign the Bonhoeffer Confession, but he did. He was responsible for about a fourth of the White Rose arrest just by naming names. He wavered between resistance and patriotism. One day he would think, oh, I've got to be a good German. The next day he would think, oh, Germany's doing bad stuff. Oh, I've got to be a good German. German's doing, and that instability was really dangerous to the group. I'm glad she's patient. His sister Susanna, on the other hand, never intended to be involved with the resistance. She was a musician, an excellent musician. She was majoring in two instruments. She was apolitical, but she hated Nazis, and she got into fights with her father all the time. She wrote brutally honest memoirs after the war, but unfortunately, both she and her brother are now members of the Republikaner, which is the furthest white right-wing political group that's allowed in Germany. So it's like now she recants everything that was in her memoirs. Traute is my absolute favorite. She was really the one who got the resistance going. She outwitted her Gestapo interrogator. I sat there laughing. The first time I read hers, she like stayed a step ahead of him. He would ask her a question, and she would answer it, thinking about what the next question was going to be that he asked her. Just incredibly funny stuff. I'm sure people thought I was crazy because I was just dying laughing. And I asked her about it in 96. I said, how could you outwit him? She said, oh, he was pretty stupid. So, but he was also, that interrogator was executed after the war for violations of the Geneva Convention, so he wasn't that stupid. She was rearrested after her initial prison term and was about to be executed 2 days after the Americans liberated her prison in Bayreuth. Paul Moot was another theologian who influenced them greatly. He really pounded in separation of church and state. He felt like that was Germany's biggest problem. Lieselotte is another favorite. She's a darling. I wish she could come speak to y'all. She is an amazing person. She called herself timidly courageous. She didn't feel like she did enough. She was the niece of a German Supreme Court judge who resigned in early 1933, could not be part of the Nazi legal thing. And she still to this day does not know why the Gestapo released her. Werner Scholl was the first Scholl to practice resistance, and Inge Scholl wrote him out of the story. I don't know why, I have no clue. He was a major influence on Otto and Sophie because he was practicing resistance while they were still, maybe. And Werner Scholl was going and setting off firecrackers and throwing them into Nazi rallies and unplugging speakers and doing things like that. He was like 14. He went missing in action in Russia. And then there's all the rest. Keita, she was a brilliant scholar. His intellect and friendship were critical. Yosef Sörngen, he was a Hanschel's true lover, not any of the girls. Gisela Schertling, even she found redemption. The Gestapo estimated that there were 180 people, and one of our goals is to try to find the all 180 names and identify who they thought were such terrible traitors that they would have been involved in something like this. And they were all very afraid, but they did what they could. Okay. The last 5 minutes are actually a prepared statement, stuff that's too important to not miss. It does us no good at all if we know the story of the White Rose, not even if we know the real story and can distinguish it from the legend. It does us no good at all if we do not comprehend what they did and why it matters. Are they historical characters worthy of the best Hollywood depiction of their lives? Absolutely. That hadn't happened, but it should. But their lives mean much more to us than shadows on a silver screen or pages in a text. I dare say that Sophie Scholl would be deeply grieved if we honored her solely by sticking her bust in Valhalla without grappling with her life. Her death, that was tragic and heroic, but her life and their lives made it so. Alex, Willie, Professor Huber, Hans, Sophie, and Crystal, their deaths will have been in vain if we are content to remember without acting. What benefit do we derive from Trauta's unbelievable spunk, Keita's steadfast faith and idealism, Lilo's timid courage, Gerhardt's courageous fear, Wilhelm Geyer's sweet confidence and firm no, Harald Dorn's raging dissent, if we stop with the memory? To honor them, as we have tried to do here today, we should be as open and receptive to righting the wrongs in our own backyard as they were. These students did not die protesting the brutality of colonialism on the African continent, America's damnable separate but equal laws, or pogroms in Russia. They focused on injustice they witnessed, on indignities that were perpetrated by their own people. Willie's nightmares of bestial deeds he had seen firsthand spurred him to do something. Eugen Grimminger's close contact with the Jewish community taught him how cruel and inhuman Nazi justice could be. The same held true for Trauta and Crystal, where friends, neighbors, and stepmom were endangered because of genetics alone. Whether they had personal reasons for protest or whether they merely recognized injustice when they saw it, once aroused, they could not keep silent. If everyone cowered under fear of denunciation, if everyone kept their mouth shut, later claiming inner immigration, then Germany would be lost, their Germany, land that they loved and cherished. For these students and the adults who learned from them were patriots in the truest sense of the word. Sure, the primary physical damage in the form of humiliating deportations followed by sadistic murders happened to the Jewish community and others deemed subhuman by the Nazis, such as Roma and Sinti. But the students of the White Rose argued that if nothing were done to stop Hitler and his henchmen, the real losers would be Germans and Germany, land that they loved and cherished. For worse than physical death, Germany faced moral, intellectual, and spiritual death unless her people stood up and shouted a collective no. As we know, that did not happen. Besides the White Rose, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, and a very small number of crazy, foolhardy idealists like them, most Germans did not say no. They tolerated the evil, closed their eyes to injustice, and hoped it would never happen to them. Because this no never came, Germany continues to struggle to regain its moral footing. As an aside, a common complaint among contemporary German Jewish citizens is that many Germans expect them to be Germany's moral voice, a pedestal they don't feel comfortable standing on. Sure, it's a beautiful country, the people are friendly and helpful, and I love going there. From Berlin's heart-pounding energy to Munich's relaxed Gemütlichkeit, with all the wonderful towns and villages in between, it's a great place to visit, a great place to live, and ironically, these days, a pretty safe place to live Jewishly, especially if you look at the rest of Europe. Yet Germany has not recovered from the silence, from that refusal to say no. More than 60 years later, the voices of the White Rose resound so clearly because they were singular. Does this mean that they risked their lives for nothing? No. They did all that was humanly possible and then some to turn the tide. That their pleas fell on deaf ears was no reflection on them, but rather on the nation as a whole. Some will try to say that the White Rose represents some sort of atonement for Germany, that their morality somehow makes up for what the rest of the country did not do. But these kids, they would be the first to decry such a notion. Guilty, 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 they proclaimed anyone who read the leaflets defining the atrocities and yet did nothing. 300,000 Jews murdered, can you believe it? They were certain that such a crime would be enough to stir the populace to revolt. After all, this was Germany with the Enlightenment, rationalism, all that good stuff. Wouldn't the nation of Goethe and Schiller, Heinrich Heine and Mendelssohn rise up if only they knew? But they did know, and they did not rise up. The story of the White Rose can be boiled down to one very simple and very basic principle. As individuals, we are responsible for acting rightly, even if no one else does so. Traute Lafrenz told me in November 2002 that I should not expect to make things right regarding White Rose history, but I must do what I know is right. And that's the essence of this thing. It is what fascinates and astonishes us about their story. Common people, just like you and just like me, they took on an evil empire. Maybe they didn't win, but Germany certainly lost in more ways than one. When I come to the end of my life, I want people to say, she may not have won all the time, but she did what was right. Because in the long run, that's all that matters.
Questions? We're ready for some questions. We'd like to see student hands.
I can't believe there's no questions.
They're thinking about making time for the meeting about Darfur, where approximately 300,000 people have been murdered. Yes?
Probably 50, 50 that I have been able to identify about 50. There's going to be a large group in Saarbrücken, Lilienthal, that will probably be, whenever we can get those archives, hopefully in DC, that will open up probably another 50, because they were duplicating leaflets. Well, in July 94, when I found them on the calendar, I had never heard of them. Like I said, I've been taking German since seventh grade. That was a long time before, so it's like, if I don't know the story, then Americans don't even know about it. So I wrote the first draft of my book and finished it by December 94, and then I went to Germany to fill in the gaps. And when I got there, the first person I wanted to interview was Inga Scholl. And she told me, I've written the only book that needs to be written about the White Rose. So she refused an interview. So I thought my project was dead in the water. So I would always tell people when I called them, Inga Scholl has refused an interview. And people would say, good, I'll tell you stuff I haven't told anybody in 60 years. Because it turned out that nearly everybody who's connected with families of the White Rose hates Inga Scholl more than I do, because she's suppressed all this information about their loved ones to make her stuff look better. So one person would tell me about this person, and I fell in love with the story. The surviving family members are precious. Like Lilo, when we met her, she was apologizing. She's now 91, and she said, well, you know, we met her in 2002, and she said, I'm just not doing so good these days. 2 years ago, I swam all the way across Starnberger See, but I was 86 then. They're just delightful, delightful people who have been grieved by the lack of real respect for what the whole group did. So, kind of, it started off as just a short project and turned into a, I want to honor them.
Not particularly with the schools, but how
classes
taught
the
White Rose
is in the country? Oh, yeah! Oh, yeah!
The question was whether in schools where the Holocaust might be taught in Germany, whether the White Rose is also taught.
It's become the Scholl family business. Inga got over $1 million under the Marshall Plan, which she wasn't entitled to, so she was a Nazi. And it's really become the Scholl family business to promote her version of the White Rose. And she basically controlled the White Rose Foundation that's in Munich, and they basically do what she and her heirs now tell them to do. And there have been 3 movies made about the White Rose, all of them very romanticized, and nothing, all of them put Hoover's this wonderful anti-Nazi, and Hans and Sophie lead them into the sunset with their brilliance, you know, and it's a fake version of it. And one of the people told me that actually what I've done here could only be done by an American because there's so many taboos in Germany. That, like, some of them, the first people who wrote about the White Rose have basically been kicked out of academia for taking on the Scholls. Christian Petri, I don't know if you're familiar, he was the first person to write. He was kicked out of the university he taught at for saying something negative about the Scholls. So it's, yes,
in Germany?
Yes. So I'm hoping to get him on board with us and say, there's a place for you. But so yes, it's taught, but it's taught in this very highly censored, it's sacred cows. There are plenty of sacred cows. You just don't talk about the bad things. Yeah. Yes?
When Sophie said that she thought she had caused a stir, she got arrested publicly. Did she?
The stir was caused.
Did she say anything?
The students got together and protested against them. The day of the execution, the trial and execution of February 22nd, the Nazi student leader got thousands of students together and they dissociated themselves. It had exactly the opposite effect of what she thought. In fact, one of the little sweet ironies, this woman in Hertha Buhl, she was the daughter of the captain who was in charge of the student company that all the guys who were in the military belonged to. And she was dating Alex's half-brother, Erich. And so on this day, when they're having this big rally, they announced, oh, and by the way, we have now arrested Schmorell. Well, they didn't say Alex Schmorell, they just said, we've arrested Schmorell. And she was, oh my God, they got Erich. And so she was running out of the assembly, but she was like, it just made her sick because the janitor who had arrested them, he was taking his bows, and the students were like jeering the White Rose. And so Sophie was completely wrong. There was no support at all for her.
In World War II, when the educational system was rebuilt in Germany, like, did the White Rose come out in a much different light, or was it ever presented in the context of ethical criticism and positive light?
When? I'm sorry.
Following World War II, the educational system in Germany was...
Well, it wasn't talked about at all, hardly, until 1968. They had annual memorial conferences for a couple of years afterwards, where people like Romano Guardini, the theologian, he spoke at the first one. Unfortunately, he didn't know anything about what they'd done, so it's just this big, oh, we the Catholics were really good type of speech. And then for a few years after that, there were a few more memorial services on their behalf, but it really gained impetus in 1968 with the student revolts that were along with the student revolts here in the United States because of the Vietnam War, where this Christian Petri, who wrote the first history of the White Rose, he and Christoph Pope's son came out and said, we need to emulate the idealism, we need to emulate the White Rose, but not their idealism. We need to be what they were not because they were too idealistic to be successful. We students in Munich now must overthrow the establishment who's perpetrating evil throughout the world and all this. And because of that, then it was suppressed for about 15 years. And so it started back up again in 83 with annual White Rose things, and that's when there was a lot of, the Scholl family business started really in 1983. So.
I have a question. What was the financial background of some of the student leaders, and did it aid in their ability to achieve what they achieved?
A good question. And Sophie was their accountant. She had apprenticed with her father, who was a CPA, and so she kept the books. But she had to be careful because she couldn't record this $40,000, because then they would have to, if they were caught, she would have to tell where they got the $40,000. So she just basically kept the expenses and not the income, which the Gestapo then hate. You know, it's like, oh, you've got to explain where your income came from. I don't know. You know, it just happened. But she did. She actually did stuff like they figured out that if they mailed the leaflets from the cities where the leaflets were going to, it only cost 8 pfennig, 64 cents per letter, whereas if they mailed it from Munich to Vienna, it would be 12 pfennig. So she did all the calculations to figure out which cities it was the most profitable to buy a train ticket to and mail it from there, and which cities it was better to just do. I mean, she was really pretty much of an accounting whiz when it came to managing their money. So she actually handled their money that Grimminger gave them. And like I said, it was all women that gave them money. So it's kind of, that side of it's kind of interesting. Good question.
Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to answer the person who asked, because I went to German schools after the war. I started in 1949 and I left Germany in the end of 1963. So I went to the whole gymnasium and the first years of the university. And we did learn about it. We did learn about it. I actually still, for this course, always refer to my German history books. We did learn about it. And now there are many, many streets and schools named, you know, everywhere, schools and streets named, you know, after them. But we did learn about it. So I just thought that would be interesting to add.
Did you learn about the Holocaust alongside of it?
Oh, yeah. That's why I'm here, because I learned in German schools about the Holocaust. Yeah, I did. And by my history teacher, who was also my religion teacher, because he could choose to take religion classes, and I did. And that's where I learned about the Holocaust first. Bishop Ockett book, 1958 or so.
Would you have your hand up? Would you like to ask a question?
No, but I want to see it.
It's the last days of the bunker, and he had a very young secretary, and she showed her the young woman. She's about 92 now, so, and she said at the time, "Oh, I was just young and I didn't understand, and I just wanted to be up in the glory of Hitler." And then she said at the end, "But I saw the memorial to Sophie Scholl, and she said, I realized we were born the same year." And she said, "I should have spoken up." Mm-hmm. So that contrast was interesting between the one woman who is now old and the other woman who has gone on.
The name of that movie again is Downfall, and it's based on Hitler's secretary's recounting and her memoirs of working with Adolf Hitler. Yes?
I was going to ask, do you know leaflets, how at the end it says, please do the case and pass along? Is there evidence of students who actually did, like, go out of their way and just continue to distribute? Was there a lot of that?
Not a whole lot, but there was. In fact, one of the Gestapo kept track of which leaflets were turned in when, and so you kind of get an idea of when people were duplicating them, because it's like there'll be a whole bunch that went out on June the 30th, and then there will be some that went out July 2nd or 3rd, so it's like, oh, so those were people who did. There's one documented thing of she wasn't a student at the university, she was a nanny who was about 19 years old, and her name was Lisa Grote, and she and her friends typed out about 20 copies of each leaflet, and they would stick them in baby carriages when they were walking through the park and things like that. There was a hat check girl in Bonn who got hold of the leaflets, and she would stick copies of them in the coat pockets of people who checked their coats. The writer, Werner Bergengrun, he distributed about 200. He and his wife typed out by hand 200. And then a successor group, after all the arrests and trials, it was around a group of what the Nazis called half-Jewish students at the University of Munich in the chemistry department, and they distributed, carried the torch. And one of those, they were all caught, and one of those guys was executed in January 1945 for doing it. So yeah, the biggest thing, though, is that in July of 1943, the British got hold of it through back roads. It went through the German resistance in Berlin to a bishop in Norway, who then passed it on to the English. And the English printed up thousands and thousands and thousands of copies of Hoover's Leaflet 6 and dropped them from airplanes.
Yeah, my mother saw those in northern Germany. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's like they really got a great distribution at the end. Yes?
The white most people, we're very great and they did a wonderful thing, but the bottom line is, has it been effective in any way, shape, or form? I mean, what did your research come up with as far as the effect of the activity?
I think if they hadn't been arrested and they had been able to go on and do what they were talking about, assassinating Hitler, and especially if they, the Harnack's cousin was Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was very actively involved in Berlin resistance. I think that if they had been able to make their February the 25th meeting with Bonhoeffer, that then they would have been able to link in to that group and done something effective. Because one thing that they knew that the people in Berlin did not know was they knew where Hitler ate in Munich. It was this little bitty restaurant called Osteria, and he ate there because when he was a starving corporal before he became the Führer, one of the waitresses there would feed him when he had no money, so he stayed loyal to that restaurant. Every time he was in Munich, he would eat there. There's a real funny story. Alex and Lilo were there, and they, when Hitler comes in, so Lilo said, you could hear a pin drop. It was just, you know, the Führer's here, the Führer's here. And Alex goes, smells like sulfur, real loud. And she's like, you're going to get us killed. But they always planned, and this is what they were going to work out with the people in Berlin, to assassinate him in that restaurant. So I think that if they had been able to live and make that February the 25th meeting, that things could have happened differently. So it's like what they did wasn't effective, but where they were going with what they were doing was effective. And plus, you just got to give them brownie points for speaking up, you know? And Willie Graf and one of his friends, Willie Bullinger in Saarbrücken, Willie had been trying to recruit other people in Saarbrücken, and everybody was slamming the door in his face, and he was so depressed. He goes to Willie Bullinger's house, and they sat up all night talking, and they said, okay, let's calculate, assuming best possible thing, assuming we can get 10,000 of these leaflets out, assuming everybody who gets one sends it to two people, we will have reached 2% of the German population. If everybody who gets it acts on it, we still only have reached 2%. And they were like, is it worth it knowing that only 2% could ever get it? And they were like, yeah, it's worth it. They couldn't live with their consciences.
So. Okay, thank you very, very much. I'd like to point out that the Human Rights Club and the Darfur Action is going to meet in that corner. Please bring your response papers up. They go in a pile behind where they're labeled.